Welcome to Lumbridge Knight's Guide for the Dragon Slayer 1 quest. In my opinion, this is the quintessential OSRS quest, and one of my personal favourites. Not only is it the longest free-to-play quest, but it's also the most rewarding, so if you want that full rune or that full green dehide, you need to watch this video and put Elvarg in a hurt locker.
Well met, adventurers. I'm the Lumbridge Knight, your guide to all things old-school RuneScape. Blessings of Saradomin be upon us as we venture forth.
So here we are at Dragon Slayer 1. Unlike many of the other free-to-play quests in old-school RuneScape, this one is quite complicated and quite long in comparison. There aren't many long-length quests in free-to-play, but this is the kind of closest thing you're going to get to a member's quest, and it's really meant to whet your appetite and get you interested in that content. So before we start, you can see on the screen there, we're going to need quite a lot of items. We're going to need 3 planks. These are obtainable only by 3 means in free-to-play. The first is you buy them from the Grand Exchange, not an option if you are an Ironman, like I am in this video. You can get them from the new Camdozal Vault as rewards from some of the chests. And this is where I got mine from. You can see the short. I'll put a link to the short on the screen. You can get planks from the wilderness. There's quite an easy method that's relatively safe for hardcore Ironmen and Ironmen in general to do, where you teleport to the Ferox Enclave, and from there, the Graveyard of Sorrows, I think it's called, is just a short walk, and just pick a non-sociable time so you're not going to get picked off by any PKs. Moving on quickly, you'll need 90 nails, a hammer, an unfired bowl, a wizard mine bomb, a lobster pot, a piece of silk, an anti-dragon shield obtainable during the quest, an air and lore rune if you're going to use telekinetic grab, so you need 33 magic as well, or 10,000 coins. Adamant armor or better for the fight with the dragon, and plenty of food, preferably lobster or better. If you're going to use the telekinetic grab to deal with Lozar the goblin, you'll also need some form of range or magic attack, so make sure you bring your bow and ammunition or some runes. So before we get into it, just one thing. If anyone wants me to do like a video on how and where to get these items and kind of the setup for the quest, let me know in the comments and I'll consider doing a Dragon Slayer preparation video just to like walk people through what you need in preparation to do this video. If not, if you're all happy to get these items, they're generally quite basic and RuneScape Wiki covers it all, and I hope this video is useful. So let's get into it. So here we are outside of the Champions Guild. It's south of Varrok. You can see by my inventory on display there that I've got all of the quest items required, as well as the Chronicle. Here it is on the map, just double check. And you can see that I've got 41 quest points and all the quests are completed. So there's more than enough quest points contained within the free-to-play game to enable you to enter the Champions Guild and start this quest, as it only requires 32 quest points. As I said, the Chronicle's there with 2 charges. This is just to make moving around a little bit easier. Throughout the video, I'll probably skip a lot of the transitions just to save time and cut down on the video length. So, once you're ready, enter the Champions Guild. Oh, as a quick point, I'll just show you my equipment there. You can see that I'm basic wearing full rune. I've got an adamant body, amulet of accuracy because that's the best my hardcore Ironman can deal with, and I've got a mithril kite because that's the best shield I've got at the moment.
Hello there.
When you're ready, speak to the guildmaster and ask him for a quest. That's option 2. He will offer you the Dragon Slayer 1 quest and refer you to Oziach. I don't know what it is up with this game and names that I can't pronounce, but anyway.
Oziach is a middle-aged salesman with ties to the Champions Guild.
And he'll tell you that Oziach lives in Edgeville, and then you go see him and ask him if he will sell you rune plate and dragon dehide bodies. So I'm going to skip ahead, and here we are in Edgeville, and Oziach is the northwesternmost building in Edgeville. So speak to him and ask him for some plate body. Go through the narrative, he'll say, how do you know that? Tell him that the guild master, so option 1, sent you, and he'll kind of whinge about adventurers and heroes always turning up. I think you can answer either one, but just say that he'll give you a quest, that's option 1, and he'll tell you to slay the dragon. Again, reply with option 1, say you can kill the dragon, and he'll send you this point back to the guild master to get advice on how to kill a dragon. So use one of your chronicle charges or a teleport to Varrok and head back to the Champions Guild. Once there, tell the guild master that he gave you a quest.
So hello there.
2. He'll ask what you did. You'll tell him he wants you to kill the dragon of Crandor, and the guildmaster will proceed to tell you the story of Crandor, which used to be some sort of successful trading city until the dragon turned up and basically wiped everyone out with the fire breath. He will then say that in order to find Crandor, there was a map split into 3 pieces, so you need to find each piece of the map. And then you also need to find a shield capable of repelling dragon breath, otherwise you will die. Now at this point in the narrative, it's really important when you speak to the guildmaster to ask him every single option. So I'm not going to repeat what they said in every single one, you'll just have to read through. But ask about the map, ask about every piece of the map, and then go through every other option. So you'll then get a key to Melzar's maze. He'll then tell you about Lozar, one of the goblins, and he'll then mention something about Thalzar. Those are the three map locations. He'll then tell you about getting a ship, and he'll then tell you to speak to the Lumbridge Duke, Duke Horatio, I believe he's called, to get a dragon breath shield. So I'm going to use my teleport home and get the dragon breath shield first. So head to Lumbridge and speak to the Duke. You can see that in between this, I've gone to the bank and deposited some of my lobsters because I didn't have enough inventory space.
Hello.
Tell him that you seek a shield, option one, and then tell him you're going to kill the dragon, option one again. He'll ask if you're sure, and then select option one again. He'll then go through a bit of a backstory. Ask him if he's going to give you the shield or not, option two, and the Duke will give you the anti-dragon shield. Boom. There's one objective done, and we're going to just wear the anti-dragon shield for the rest of this quest, just for the sake of it. So, deposit the mithril shield. So you can see I skipped some of the transition there. I teleported to Faldor and then headed southwest, and here is Melzar's Maze on the map. Enter, make sure you've got the key that the guildmaster gave you. Melzar's Maze is essentially like a puzzle chamber, so each area, there's sort of one right door, and there's one mob that will drop the key when you kill it. So in this room, we're looking for one of the smaller rats, so ignore the bigger ones, and we're looking for the small rat with the long tail. So you can just see it there, it's on the right-hand side of the screen. The zombie rat I'm attacking there, and you can see that it's got a much longer tail than the other ones. It's very easy to kill, and it drops the red key. And you can see there's three red doors, and we need to use that key that we just got on the door to the northwest. So you can see the one on the screen there, just follow the one that I've gone through. You know it's the right door because there's a table, chairs, a bookcase, and the weird like dragon, red dragon picture. So head through there and up the ladder. I've also added this handy little mini map courtesy of RuneWiki. So you can use that and that indicates which is the correct door. You're now in a room with ghosts. You're then supposed to identify a ghost without the cape. So all the other ghosts in the room will have long hair or a cape. Find the one ghost that doesn't. Identify it and kill it. You can kind of see it there. It's got a hood on, but not really got a proper full-length cape, whereas all the other ones seem to have full-length capes or hair. Find that ghost, kill it, and we should get an orange key from this one. So there we go, take the orange key. Once you have the orange key, you want to head to the northern middle door. So there's four orange doors. You want the northern middle one. Check the minimap on screen there if you're not sure, and head through that door and up the ladders. And you're now in a room full of skeletons. Now we're now looking for the skeleton, I believe, with the circular shield. You can just see him there hiding in the top right of the screen. So we need to find him and kill the skeleton with the circle shield. None of the things other than the lesser demon are particularly difficult to kill in this dungeon, hence why I only brought 7 lobsters with me. If you're a bit lower level than I am, I'm kind of like base 40s, maybe a bit higher, bring more food. You didn't need to bring some of the quest items that I brought. You could have left most of them in the bank for this. You don't actually need any of them, and you could have brought a full inventory of food if you were worried. He's going to now drop the yellow key, and we want the most southwestern door. Luckily, it's the one he was stood right next to, so here we go, straight through. Keep checking my little mini map to ensure you're selecting the correct doors. This leads us in a long L-shaped corridor, and we're going to head along there and down the ladder. You'll find yourself in a small tower room, so head down the opposite ladder, and then you'll find yourself in another sort of T-shaped room. Again, there's nothing of interest in either of these rooms, so just look for the other ladder and head straight down. At the bottom, you'll find yourself in a small room with a normal-looking door and a blue door, as well as 2 zombies. There's no difference in these, just kill them until they drop the blue key. Don't go through the normal door. As you can see, I've got a random event. I'm going to dismiss the dunce there. See you later. Not interested. There we go. I've killed one and got the blue key. So head through the blue door. Watch out when you go in here because you have to fight Melzar the Mad. He uses spells, but he's not particularly difficult. A lot of his spells turn into like cabbages and weird stuff. And he casts Weaken, I think, over and over again. So he's really not that difficult to kill. He just takes a while. I kind of hovered over my prey. I was a little bit worried when I remembered he was a spellcaster, but he's not particularly difficult. He uses a lot of melee mixed in with spells, but obviously he's not decked out for melee attack, so he doesn't really deal a lot of damage. So once you've killed him, by the power of Custard, hopefully I kill him soon. I mean, if he was drinking his tea in peace, it's a bit rude of you to walk in and kill him, but kill him, get that like magenta purple key and head through the door. Now I hesitated a little bit here, but if you stay in that room, obviously you can see there another Melzar popped up and began attacking me. So I just went through the door rather than wasting another one of my lobsters. Now what you can do with this lesser demon is like sort of safe spot him. So behind these torches is kind of like a safe spot. So if you can lure the lesser demon here, you can like pop out from cover using run, hit him and jump back into cover before he retaliates. So this is what I tried to do. I think in the end I end up just tanking him, just, you know, standing toe-to-toe and killing him. But if you're low level, you can definitely sort of flinch the guy and get away with it. I'm not very good at it, so I didn't really succeed. But you can see how when I move here, he doesn't really want to attack me. So if I move here, he won't come and attack me. So you can keep darting back and forward and attacking him. The problem there is obviously if your character doesn't move far enough, or you're not quite quick enough on the attack, he just wanders off and you don't get the attack in. So you can see I tried the flinching method a number of times with mixed results. Sometimes it worked perfectly like it did about there. Other times he managed to catch me anyway because I was a bit too slow clicking. It's quite hard to do and get it right perfect, but if you've got low food like I have, it's kind of a must. I did get bored about now and just start going toe to toe with the guy. I was a little bit anxious because I didn't bring enough food. So my advice really looking back would be to deposit a lot of the quest items that you don't need and just bring a full inventory of food. It just makes things a little bit easier and takes the pressure off. Now remember, once you've killed him as well and got the green key, use it on the green door quite quickly because another one will spawn in behind this one. Yeah, ashes and a green key. So grab the green key. Don't go up the ladder. Make sure you open and search the chest before you do, because if you go up that ladder, you're back at the start and you have to go through the entire maze all over again. So open the chest, search it, and there's your first map piece. Congratulations. Now on to the next one. So we need to get ourselves out of Melzar's maze. There's no point inspecting it like I tried to do there. You can't do anything until you've got all three pieces. Carry on and exit the dungeon. And that is the end of Melzar's maze. That's probably the most complicated bit in Dragonslayer. So well done. You completed the most time consuming part of the quest, essentially. The other stuff, we've either got the items already, or it's not particularly difficult.
Please like the video and support my content. Thank you, noble knight.
So I just thought I'd jump in with a bit of Lumbridge trivia. Do you need to complete Dragonslayer in order to unlock blue dragonhide bodies? I know this is a members item, but I just wondered, do you know the answer to this question? Find out at the end of the video. So we're now on to the next map piece. So we head to Ice Mountain. You can see I'm already there. I've also grabbed the Skull Scepter at some point just to make the teleporting around a little bit easier. I use the Skull Scepter to teleport closer to the Dwarven Mines. And you need to talk to the Oracle on top of Ice Mountain. So I'm walking to see her there and just speak to the weird icy blue Oracle woman. Tell her you seek the map of Crandor, and she gives you this kind of weird sort of cryptic clue. First, a drink used by a mage, next some worm string changed to sheet, then a small crustacean's cage, last a bowl that's not seen heat. So this refers to the weird items we've got, so that's the wizard mind bomb, the sheet of silk, the lobster pot, and the unfired bowl. That's the answer to the riddle. And what we need to do now is go into the Dwarven Mine, so head down the mountain, and see where I'm going now, and into the Dwarven Mine. Now if you've ever been in the Dwarven Mine, you probably noticed the weird looking like tomby thing to the west. It's kind of yellow, it's got sort of magic fires and stuff around it, and the weird door with the snakes. There we go. And this is what we're going to do. We're going to use each of those items in turn on the door. Make sure you don't drink your wizard mind bomb, because that's a pain in the neck going back to Thalzar to buy a new one. So use that, use the unfired bowl, use the silk, and use the lobster pot. I don't think it matters which order. That wasn't even the right order there, so it definitely doesn't matter which order you use the items in. But it still opens the door, you get this cool little RuneScape cutscene. The door opens and you enter. Once inside, you simply open the chest and search it. There's a little note there from the last guy saying he used his magic to hide his piece of the map rather than destroy it as he was told to. But yeah, open the chest, search it, and you get the second piece of the map. Great, so there's now only one piece left from the goblin Lozar. So I went back to Thalzar, made sure I've got a air rune and a lore rune. The reason I went back to Thalzar is because I used mine to teleport.
No!
I should have kept hold of it. I didn't bring enough to start with. So make sure you grab those. We need to head to the south of Port Sarum, to the jail there. You can see it on the map here. And inside the jail, there's only one goblin, so you can't get them mixed up. Once you've entered, you will find the goblin Lozar, located in the third cell. You'll either need 33 magic in order to use telekinetic grab, or you'll have to have 10,000 coins in order to negotiate and buy the map fragment from him. I recommend removing your armor if you're going to use the range option, and that's what you'll see me do in the video. If you're going to use magic, just make sure you've got the runes, and reduce his health to zero. When you do, he will drop the map piece on the floor, and you will then need to use telekinetic grab in order to pick it up. As I've said, if you do not possess the magic level for telekinetic grab, you'll have to speak to him and then pay him 10,000 coins for the map piece. I really didn't want to do this, and I don't think any hardcore Iron Man can afford to waste 10,000 coins at this point, so you'll see me use telekinetic grab in the video. Boom! Now you've got all three, you can use them on each other and get the full map, which looks something like this. It's even got a nice little dragon thing at the top. Okay, so the next thing on the list was a boat, I believe. So there is a boat called the Lady Lumbridge, suitable that the Lumbridge Knight would sail on such a vessel. And here she is. You can buy her for the grand sum of 2,000 coins. Here it is on the map, exactly where the boat is. Ship to Crandor is what you're looking for. Happily, I've been wandering around with precisely that number of gold coins in my inventory since the start of the video. So buy the Lady Lumbridge from Captain Clarence for 2,000 gold. He even throws in the cabin boy, Jenkins. So just pay that, I don't think you can negotiate it down, and there you go. You now own a boat. So cross the plank, don't bother talking to the cabin boy, there's nothing to be gained by speaking to him. Instead, head down to the hold, head down the ladder, and you'll notice straight away there's a big hole. And this is what you wanted your three planks, your 90 nails, and your hammer for. Click on the hole, and you need to click three times in order to totally repair the hole. So that's twice, and once more. Boom! And she's good as new. The last thing you now need in order to set sail to Crandor is obviously we need to stock up for the battle with the dragon, get rid of some of the items we're not going to use, and we also need a captain. It just so happens that Ned, the rope maker, here he is in Draenor Village, is a sea captain and he's desperate to get back out on the open sea. Here he is on the map, just in case. It was obviously Easter when I did this, so you can see Greg the Easter Bunny there as well. You can see him there. Just speak to Ned, ask him if he's up for being captain.
I used to be an adventurer like you.
There you go, you're a sailor.
And I took an arrow in the knee.
He's not so sure he wants to go to Crandor, because it's obviously a bit of a death sentence. But just to get back out on the open seas, he's happy to do it. So here we go, boom. Didn't take much persuasion at all. You give the map to Ned, and he says he'll meet you back on the Lady Lumbridge at Port Sarum. So, this is now the point of no return for the battle with the dragon. You need to go to the bank and prep for a fight, because once you set sail on that boat, there ain't no coming back, unless you got teleport runes, of course. So, if you're hardcore Iron Man, or you don't want to die and lose anything, I definitely recommend bringing some teleport runes. I brought teleport runes, or I brought the Chronicle, just in case I was about to die, I could get the hell out of there. So, you can see I'm now taking a full inventory of lobster, taking the Chronicle as a teleport, in case I need to get the hell out of Dodge. Make sure you set your weapon to a stab, because Elvarg is vulnerable to stab. Make sure your prayers recharged. I should have brought a strength potion, and I should have gotten to the monastery before and then got them extra 2 prayer points, because you'd see my prayers currently full on 37. I could have got it 2 points higher by training at the monastery. Just a quick FYI on the monastery there, you need to be level 31 in order to access the second floor and use the altar to recharge to get the bonus prayer points. You can see I was really cocky and I brought my hardcore Iron Man armor, which is obviously the equivalent of iron. You'll have to wait and see if I manage to coup de grace the dragon, thinking I was cocky with my hardcore Iron Man armor or not. If anyone's seen the shorts I made, you'll know the answer to that already. Anyway, here's my final equipment, you can see. I'm rocking full rune, bar the body, which I'm using adamant. I've got my anti-dragon shield, green dragon vams, the fighty boots, cabbage cape, and rune longsword. Speak to Ned, tell him you're ready to go when you've got that full inventory of lobster, and off you go to Crandor. You get this little extended cutscene, and it's quite a good cutscene actually, it's pretty funny. As far as RuneScape goes, I think this is the best the graphics get. Starts with a standard boat transition screen, and then it moves to a more Crandor-based one. And then when you get close, Ned will start speaking. until all of a sudden, some strange storm clouds form on the horizon, and there's some bolts of lightning, and I'm going to kind of leave the normal audio in so you can hear what the cutscene actually sounds like. Ensign Redshirt starts talking there, the dragon starts flying over, and oh my god. Unfortunately, Ensign Redshirt, aka Jenkins the cabin boy, is about to get eviscerated. So the ship's on fire, the dragon's attacking. It's really quite a cool cutscene. Oh, and there we go. Jenkins is incinerated. No more Jenkins. Ned thinks we're going to sink, but then there's land, so we're going to crash. Boom. RIP Lady Lumbridge. I don't think we're going to get to repair that one. Gutted. So at this point, we're now on Crandor anyway, so we made it. It's just time to take care of the dragon. Now I'm going to speed the video up, but what you need to do is head to the top, that big hole there. You can just see on the screen at the top is where we're aiming for. So make your way around the volcano sort of thing. It's just one big sort of circular path. Ignore the lesser demons. You don't want to be taking damage before you get going. Enter the hole, and here we are at the dragon. There's a few mobs. I think the skeletons are aggressive. One of them tries to have a go at me. I just quickly got over the edge before I took any damage. Be wary though. Yep, here you go. As soon as you walk over, you would get instantly attacked. And this bugger was not messing about. She hit me with two dragon fires and took like half my health off straight away. So get that defense from magic up. And hopefully continue to kill Elvarg. She is not an easy fight, and I particularly made this look difficult because I didn't bring a strength potion, so I wasn't doing as much damage as I should have been, and I wasn't toggling my prayer either. So when she wasn't using dragon fire, I probably should have been turning the prayer off, because it's just a random variable how the dragon attacks. It doesn't respond to whether you've got the prayer initiated or not. Also, the other thing I could have been doing is that instead I just stood there and just tanked it. I think because I had enough food, I was kind of overconfident. And you can see at this point, I kind of thought, yes, I've got this. But my prayer runs out and she hits me with like 13 dragon fires in a row the second my prayer goes down. So that was painful. I was just eating the whole time. One thing you can do as well is if you walk to the square where the dragon stood, so you kind of walk beneath her, it stops her from attacking you because she has to then move around you to kind of get into a position to attack, which kind of buys you seconds and allows you to kind of eat without sort of giving the dragon the attack of opportunity. That's another trick I totally missed out on. So three things I think you need to do to boss this battle. Bring some strength potions. In fact, four things. Bring some strength potions. Use stab. Use her square to heal on. And also toggle your prayer. Don't just leave your prayer on defense from magic like I did. And then it runs out and she hits you with 13. Like you can see it now. It's on the screen. Just constant dragon fires. She's just burning through my lobsters. So I was pretty confident I wasn't going to die at this point, but this is the point where it's like 13 dragon fires in a row, so all I was doing was just eating constantly. God knows what she'd have hit damage-wise without that anti-dragon shield. Apparently she can hit as high as 69. That's not an experience I want to live on my hardcore Ironman. If you've been hit for 69...
69, dudes!
Leave a comment and tell me about your disastrous trip to fight Elvarg, because not many people are going to survive a hit for 69 at this point. I think my max health point is only like 50. So yeah, you can see this. I made a bit of a meal of this. Definitely take my points that I've raised on board there so that you don't do it as sort of last ditch as I did. At this point, insert sad music. It's obvious that I did not complete my fancy flourish coup de grace in my hardcore Ironman armor. Boo. As I think she would have probably killed me, and two lobsters wasn't enough for me to take that chance. Yeah, down to my last two lobsters. I was a bit worried at this point. But finally, I killed the dragon, and then you get this really awesome cutscene, which is really cool that RuneScape have modified it and added this cutscene. Boom! You rip her head off and hold her up like a hero. Yes! Really like that, and I think you get to keep the head, which you can then display on your member's house if you upgrade to membership. So, woohoo! Jump for joy. Finally, killed the dragon. It's been many weeks in the coming, but we've finally done it. Now use your teleport, use your chronicle to return to the Champions Guild. In hindsight now, the Skull Scepter might actually be a better item to take with you for the teleport, because that'll get you a little bit closer to Edgeville and just save you a few more valuable seconds. From this point, you just need to go to Edgeville. And it's now time for another bit of Lumbridge trivia. I asked you earlier if you needed to complete Dragon Slayer in order to wear blue dragonhide. The answer is no, you don't. It is only a requirement for green dragonhide. Blue, red, and black can be worn whether you've completed a Dragon Slayer or not, as long as you've got the required defense level. Strange. Anyhow, you can now see that I'm in Edgeville, and I'm withdrawing all my money so that I can buy my rune body and my green dehide body. So now let's go speak to Oziach.
Oziach.
Hand in the quest and claim our new armors. So he says, have you slayed the dragon yet? Yes, I have. And you have its head here. And he's surprised that you actually did it. You're a genuine adventurer. And that's the end of the quest. So you're then rewarded with your 2 quest points, nearly 19,000 strength experience, nearly 19,000 defense experience, and the ability to wear rune and dragon body plates. Although, as you just saw, it's only green dragon that applies to. You can wear blue, red, and black without completing this quest. So now ask if you can buy the rune body plate, and he'll say yes, no problem. And that's going to cost you 84,500 for the rune plate body, and about 10,000 for the green dehide body. You can see I've just bought both of them. The strength and defense has jumped up to 45 and 44. And when I equipped it in a second, finally, my hardcore Ironman gets to rock full rune. Sexy. And there's the stats just to prove it.
If you've enjoyed this video and it has been at all helpful, please like, subscribe, and leave a comment. I, the Lumbridge Knight, am at your service. So until the next time, fare thee well, brave adventurer.